My name is Brittany Barker. I'm a communications major at Elon University and rising junior. And today I will be presenting on Liar's Poker by Michael Lewis. We will go into discuss the Salomon Brothers, a very powerful financial firm in the late 1900s, around 1980, and Wall Street and the climb to success. The importance of the Bank of America deal, being able to read and play the stock market, a crash after the modern gold rush, and stocks and bonds in the past and the present. So first of all, the Salomon Brothers, as I said earlier, they were a very powerful financial firm. They were founded in 1910 and ceased operations in 2003. However, their peak was in 1980, around there, before a stock market crash on Wall Street that forced them to discontinue their services. So Michael Lewis, he's the author of Liar's Poker. He was a bond salesman at the Salomon Brothers and is currently a nonfiction financial author. And he was a Princeton graduate, but he had a bit of an odd start to his career with Salomon. So the ladder to success is discussed in more detail within Liar's Poker, and particularly what you needed at this time period to get a successful job within stocks and bonds. And you needed to have a resume and connections that you would have made at an internship. And in order to get the internships that you really wanted or that would lead to a more successful position later on, you needed to have an econ major, a finance major, and you needed to know what to say, but more importantly, you needed to know what not to say. Particularly, you couldn't bring up money, or more specifically, you couldn't bring up the desire to have money. Because ironically, that didn't exactly fly with firms. You needed to be more humble about it, despite once you got there and were able to kind of rake in the money, you didn't need to be as humble once you were there. But getting there, you needed to be very, very humble. Now, as I said earlier, Michael Lewis didn't exactly have the traditional route to success. He happened to have dinner in London with the Queen and happened to be sitting next to a couple of people that worked in Salomon, and he only had that connection in his econ major. The rest, he wasn't able to get an internship where his peers were and wasn't able to have those more guaranteed little rungs, if you will. So the Bank of America deal is mentioned throughout Liar's Poker. It's a more in depth with how the government and legalities and other banks that you work with as a trading and bonds firm. And it essentially ended up saving the bond market. So Louis Ranieri became the head of Salomon's mortgage bonds, and he ended up creating a monopoly. He built up the Salomon mortgage bond section of the firm or sector. And most of the other sectors at Salomon wanted to eliminate mortgage bonds. They didn't like it, they didn't think it would be successful. But because of the Bank of America deal, the head of Salomon at the time, John Goodfriend, said that Ranieri could keep it and continue to build his monopoly, essentially. And when the mortgage area had an influx of people wanting to sell mortgages, Ranieri was the only one that they could go to. And it made Salomon's mortgage sector one of their most profitable sectors in the firm. And the reason why Louis Ranieri was able to build his mortgage sector successfully is because he was able to read and play the market. So he was able to predict everything that would happen in the market more out of luck than anything else. But when it did happen, he knew how to lie which was surprising to me, that one of the biggest things they needed to know how to do was to lie to the buyers and sellers of their services, so that as a bond salesman or a stock salesman, that you could take an amount from both the buyer and the seller without any restriction. You were the one deciding what you would get from it. So you needed to know how to lie and hide that. But you also had to have an awareness of what was going on and who was getting what from each client. And then you also had to be aware of changes. So by changes, I mean the changes that were going on outside of the firm in the market and what was changing within the firm and etc. So when the mortgage sector was created, everyone knew because they knew that they had to be aware of every change that was happening, which led to a dislike and then later acceptance when it became so profitable of the mortgage sector. Now onto the modern gold rush. This idea of a gold rush in modern times came about because 24-year-olds were graduating college, going straight into the workforce and being able to rake in $200,000 in all these six digits just right off the bat out of graduating. And this is highlighted when Michael Lewis is speaking with his old financial professors and they begin discussing salaries. And as a first-year worker, Lewis is able to make more than his professor, which wasn't explicitly stated, but Lewis said that it was very visible on his face that he was surprised by the new change. And it really showed that credentials didn't really matter to an extent. You didn't need to have the experience necessarily, as long as you had that air and personality and ability to lie to people and lead them to making the decision that you wanted them to make. And it also made a point that monopolizing stocks and bonds was acceptable. It wasn't a time where monopolies were taboo. And finally, the training process in this modern gold rush was mentally and emotionally abusive. They knew that these kids were coming out of college and ready to do whatever it took to get their six digits and get out of debt. And they knew that it was going to be okay. They were treating them like the stereotypical get me coffee, cater to me, little trainees. And it was more of a cult or a culture than a workforce at that time. So then the crash. It altered the belief in money. The idea that time equals money became wit equals money. And this crash showed really that time really didn't necessarily need to be a factor in one's ability to create a decent income. And by decent, I mean extremely successful. And it led to systems becoming more defined within financial firms, because these firms were working kind of outside of legal boundaries, except for when they needed to use them to their advantage, such as with the Bank of America deal. And monopolies for stocks and bonds became unacceptable. It wasn't safe for clients because they were being taken advantage of. And while it was still a culture after this crash, the focus kind of shifted from being this personality of I have control of the money to an ability to make money without having to manipulate. So finally, stocks and bonds then and today. Michael Lewis made a point to compare what had happened in light of what happens today, particularly with the means of manipulation back then and today, where it's more regulated, there's less lying and trying to trick the market as opposed to actually playing and reading the market. There was also a decent amount of discrimination of the sex and different sexes and races, but because of checks and regulations, it's decreased significantly, though there still are less women, and it's still predominantly the white male position. And back then, there were no means of checking these trades, as I mentioned, and now it's more regulated by the government, and there are rules that these traders and sellers need to follow. And back then, there was arguably a higher risk because of the monopoly. People could only invest in one financial firm. And now, because monopolies are eliminated, people can invest more safely, putting their investments into multiple firms. And then finally, I did some research on why merging into one monopoly was so acceptable back then, and it's because it was necessary. People didn't think that they could make the money that they wanted to out of their smaller separate banks. And today, merging banks isn't ideal because of monopolies and the risk that was extracted from this crash, and the idea that everyone can lose everything if they aren't safe about it. So this is my source of the New York Times on merging, and the rest was taken from Liar's Poker by Michael Lewis. And in summary, we went over the Liar's Poker and how the Solomon Brothers really exposed a monopolized financial system and the changes that Wall Street had to make to its culture and what is and is not acceptable in the financial world today. Thank you.